How are we doing out there? All right, here we go. Kind of reminds me a little. So, yeah, it's still blues. Well, hello, everybody out there. Hi, I'm Jason with Green Country Agroforestry. Oh, hello, right there. How y'all doing tonight? 7 p.m. Wednesday. It must be time for another live show. See, Brian stopped by and said hello. Brian says, intriguing. Oh, yeah, you have to roast peanuts that you grow. Who knew? Well, unless you like eating them raw. And I do actually like eating them raw. Let me put this thing aside for the moment. Oh, pardon my backside. Oh, I should have brought that rack a bit closer. Hi, all one people who's watching. There's Vicky Savage saying many blessings. Eric Hale saying hi to Green Country Agroforestry. Hey, I'm wearing the shirt tonight. I should probably buy a couple more of them. And I would if I wasn't so broke. I know they're not expensive. If you go to the website, www.greencountryagroforestry.com, you can find shirts just like this one available currently in gray and navy blue, if you like navy blue instead. And they are not too incredibly expensive. They take a little while to get shipped out to you because they, I believe they make them out there in Georgia. Is where the, well, if you're ordering some here, somewhere here from the middle of the country out east, they make them in Georgia. I'm not sure where they make them at if you're out on the western side of the country. There's a couple of different spots where they print them up. They're print to order. So as soon as you order them in your size, they print it and then they ship it right to you. Oh, look at me doing commercials. Currently, we've got the Hemerocallis fulva orange daylily on sale. I think they're at $4.99 for a bundle. And now is as good a time as any to get those, or you can wait until early spring. Either way is fine. I don't mind. I'll have even more of them come springtime. But hopefully this will be one of the final years of a very low product as we work to build up our nursery stock. We've got a lot of fun things coming up. Of course, corn is going to be coming out soon that we'll be putting out to the website. Very good quality corn. For people that are interested in having corn that doesn't suffer from inbreeding depression. Oh my goodness, Vicky says she's got spice bush growing rampant. That's awesome. I've been wanting spice bush. So, okay, I might actually, maybe not during the winter months, but come springtime, I might put a little flag on one of those and come by and pick up a sample. Because getting spices here in the temperate zone is not easy. We've got onions. We can grow onions okay. We can grow garlic okay if the gophers don't get it. Well, you know, I've been making precautions over there. Black pepper, no, not so much. Not here unless you've got a greenhouse that can get you zone 10 around the year. And if you've got that, you may as well grow vanilla orchids because they like zone 10 too. We can grow hot peppers, cayenne peppers. I grow lots of cayenne peppers. I'm pretty good at that. But having something that can take this place of nutmeg and cinnamon, that sort of thing, spice bush will do it. Spice bush covers a couple different angles depending upon what part of the seed and fruit you're eating. Kind of like the Sichuan pepper. If you take the outside of the fruit, you have a citrus note. If you exclude the outside of the fruit and you just grind up the seed, then you have something that tastes like black pepper. So you've got that's tastes like. Not exactly the same as. So Sichuan and Sancho peppers, whenever I get the peppercorns in, I can't use those to be a source for piperine in my concoctions that I throw together. Fortunately, I've got plenty of black pepper and it's not too hard to trade with people down to the south for the moment. We can get our hands on it. Anyway, where was I at? Oh yeah, I was having a look at our peanut plant out front that produces, you know, these things, and it's doing pretty good. There's more coming. It's doing pretty good, actually, all things considered. The deep mulch underneath it is where the peanuts are forming. They're forming in the mulch. They're not forming in the soil. And as a result, the gophers haven't found it yet. So I'm getting some peanuts out of my peanut bushes plants this year. And that's great. But I was sitting around and thinking, well, you know, I don't mind eating them fresh. They're okay that way, at least to me. But that probably will require some roasting to be finished off, especially if I'm going to be putting together some sort of crazy vegetarian concoctions, like taking the leaves from my Chinese mahogany, the Tunis sinensis that I got planted this year, and combining that with a lightly roasted peanut to give you a nice protein and fat source that actually tastes like beef, but doesn't cost $15 a pound or more. I decided you have to be able to roast it lightly. And I've never been able to roast a peanut lightly in the pan. I don't have a big tumbler. And I believe those, you're going to require a little bit of oil for those anyway. So if you're going to roast peanuts, it's nice to be able to do it without burning them. And one of the simplest methods I could think of to roast a peanut without burning it would be to use forced hot air, just hot air and nothing else. So the idea that I had was, well, I'd get some way that I can get hot air and pass it through a column with racks in it that the peanuts are going to sit on. And that'll envelop the nut all the way around with hot air so it heats evenly and roasts evenly. And then I got to thinking, well, without attaching some sort of a blower or a fan to that, how will I get the air to flow through there at a sufficient rate and hot enough that would actually roast the nuts? And that's whenever my brain started cooking and I came up with an idea that I'll share with you here in a moment here. Vicky's saying, what is it that would mix with the peanuts? Let me write it down. Here's the binomial. It's called tuna, spelled T-O-O-N-A, sinensis. Sinensis, of course, since we watched the program a while back on where the plant names come from, that means it's Chinese, and tuna is the mahogany plant. Chinese mahogany. I know, it's weird. It grows here in Zone 7, and it will probably grow in Arkansas, too. It's mahogany with that nice, rich, dark wood, but as it turns out, the leaves are high in protein, and they taste kind of like beef and onions, which is why one of the common names for tuna sinensis is beef and onion plant. And they do. They did taste an awful lot like beef and onions. So I'm having visions of coming up with ways that I can have the flavor of beef in my food and not be paying an insane amount of money for beef, because it's getting really expensive out there, guys. A lot of things are getting a lot more expensive, so it's a good time to get on it with finding plants that you can get growing around your yard that are going to keep on producing for you year in and year out without a whole lot of attention from you, because you might be scrambling to get the rest of your food from somewhere. What do we have? Well, we got aforementioned peanuts here, and we got something that one of the other viewers stopped by and dropped off. There we go. There's a fig tree that is rumored to be able to survive our winters here in Oklahoma. I've got a bunch more outside. I just brought that one indoors, and I'm going to keep it indoors just to be on the safe side. You never know. They say it's going to be a cold winter. All right. Vicky says, oh, well, I'm familiar with those. Sold in the garden centers as hot tuna. T-O-O-N-A. T-O-O-N-A. Time to kill some deer for your beef. Yeah, well, I wouldn't be killing deer for beef. I'd be killing deer for venison. And most specifically to protect my my acorns and my other nuts, because, you know, deer like to eat them. But they're not coming in right yet. They're not starving as of yet. I mean, your ideal garden situation is where you wind up killing deer and squirrels and rabbits simply because you have to maintain the balance and keep their population in check. And then you have meat. Anyways, what else we got? Oh, yeah, this is a great time of year to go out to where you've got your strawberries and have a look around, because you might be surprised to discover either some strawberries, if you've got the ever-bearing variety that I have, or some new strawberry plants, which is what I've been finding in abundance the last couple of days. Every day I go out there and I prune them back a little bit. I've got a 2-foot wide strip that my strawberries are growing on the north side of the house. If they go beyond that 2-foot margin, then I harvest them and spread them around. And it looks like of the 50 some odd plants that I planted on the north side of the house, every single one of them is making anywhere from 4 to 5 little baby plants. This is a string of 3 that I just accidentally pulled up while I was doing some weeding, and I went ahead and put them in this pot. But here in the next couple of days, I'll be taking a 10-20 tray, well, probably more than one 10-20 tray, packing it with peat moss and loading it up with lots of strawberry pups and bringing those in and seeing if we can get those ready to send out come springtime, because I think I will this year probably have more strawberries than I know where I'm supposed to put them, which means that they may wind up on the market come springtime. Brian lives alone. Red says, I'm actually kind of struggling to find humanity, so this is great. Wow. Oh, it's been really nice out the last few days, though. And I'm going to turn a fan on because we got our heat on in here. Let's see. I got a fan right here. There we go. Look at this. Little fan, USB cord plugs into it, and it'll blow cool air right there on my face. I can turn it up. There's 2 speeds. It feels so nice. Okay, so let me jump over here real quick. Oh, that feels so nice. Okay, got that. All right, there we go. Hit a couple buttons real quick. Okay, we're back in business. Let's see. Brian's way behind on chores. All right. Rain knocked the seeds down. Oh, well, that's okay. There's always next year. We were out this past weekend at a little Mexican restaurant that serves some actual pico de gallo as opposed to watery salsa. Well, I mean, they have the watery salsa too, if you're satisfied with that, but they'll bring you real pico de gallo if you ask for it. And as we were on our way out the door, we stopped and grabbed a couple of cuttings from one of the plants that they had out there in the parking lot that was starting to sort of lean over the parking spaces just a little bit. So you know it needed to be pruned, of course. So we brought home 3 cuttings for Vitex. So Vitex Agnus Castus, the little purple-flowered Vitex. Really, really nice display of purple flowers that the bees love, and it's blooming this time of year, which is another reason to have it around. So hopefully we'll be able to get some of those started, and I don't know how many of those I'm going to have. Maybe 1, possibly 2. Let's see here. Get my screen light on. Oh, yep. If there's all of a sudden a crackling and a popping sound and the screen goes black, it's because I spilled my coffee on the floor here. Oh, yeah, I should have towels handy for these sorts of occasions. Brian, so I fixed my code on card. I ordered a new card. My $5. Ha ha. And can you smoke peanuts? Depending upon your use of the term smoke, If you had a smokehouse, could you put the peanuts in the smokehouse and pass scented smoke or flavored smoke across them to impart a smoky flavor to them? Yeah, I'm sure you could, and they'd probably turn out really good that way too. Red says people are going to miss the old school world. Yeah, the old world, whenever it goes bye-bye, people are just going to lose their minds, I think. I believe a lot of people will just sit here and go, huh. So the mail's not running and the power's not coming on again? What do I do? And wait for somebody to tell them what to do. That's the scary part. But we don't worry about these things because we're prepared. We're not only prepared, we're growing fig trees and peanuts and strawberries and all kinds of good stuff, right? Right? Well, yeah. And thinking about how we're going to preserve our harvest. So obviously this is going to be in the line of preserving your harvest. The thought they came up with will work good for peanuts. And if you use a small amount of fuel instead of a large amount, you should also be able to use it as a wood-fired food dehydrator. And one other thing that I thought of that just seemed a little bit too crazy and out there, but I'll show you. Oh no, Red's ticking off because not in a good mood. Anyway, let me see. Vicky says, think folks would rather smoke tobacco or kinnikinick? Yeah, oh, them peanuts, yeah. Right. All right, let me see here. Let me see here. Is Nightbot doing its thing? Yeah, Nightbot's doing its thing. Had to double check and make sure Nightbot was working. There we go. Finally, I'm seeing it. Smoked ham and pea soup. Hey, that sounds good. I just planted peas. I planted peas yesterday. There's some of those Alaska early peas, not really great as a dried field pea, but they're probably really good as a sweet pea. And I planted them alongside my potatoes. I put some radishes and some more carrots out over there. I say more carrots because that little water feature over there here to the side, I put some carrots and some bok choy and celery and broccoli rabe out there. And it's coming up whenever the grasshoppers let me have it. Grasshoppers are out and they're still hungry. And today I was out shopping around and looking for row covers and hoops and all kinds of fun stuff because I think we might wind up needing it probably about the middle of the month, which is here in about 2 more weeks or so. Well, mid to late month, October, we just might get that cold snap. Remember Almanac, wherever I put him. Oh, over there. So, preparing and preserving your harvest. You might need to dehydrate some food. You might need to roast some nuts, not necessarily peanuts, but you can also roast hazelnuts, pecans, walnuts, almonds. Any number of different nuts can be roasted. And a good way to roast them is, of course, using hot air. And how do you get hot air roasting without electricity? I mean, right now I could go and I can plug in my air fryer and put the racks in the air fryer and put the nuts on there, and I can roast in that air fryer and do a really good job of it. But if the power goes out, how do I roast nuts or dehydrate food for that matter? If I'm using a regular power dehydrator, you can get a solar dehydrator or build one. That's great. But what do you do if you want to use your dehydrator and it's just not convenient that particular time of the year because it's raining, sun's not out, too humid? Perhaps to use the solar dehydrator, you would need to have something that can actually heat air and cause air to flow through a sealed vessel. Not to worry, there is a solution. And some of you already know what it is. I'm just going to put a little tiny wrinkle on the concept and show you what I'm thinking of. What's the Almanac Maniac for my latitude? Brian, it says here you're going to freeze your backside off, is what it says. You need to have more firewood in. I'm pretty sure that's what it says. You're up here in Area 9. That is upper Midwest. Winter temperatures will be below normal. This is for everybody, right? Except people in the high plains. High plains are actually have a reprieve. Coldest periods in December, January, mid-February. So I guess you're going to have a more or less usual fall. So at least you got that going for you. Still wouldn't be a bad idea to have some row covers just in case. All right. Vicky said, I've read that nuts keep longest in the shell and uncracked. That's true. You can keep a pecan uncracked in the shell for at least 2 years or so, and it'll still be good. Maybe even longer. It all depends. Here we go. Let me get my my paint program opened up, and we'll get started working on this concept. I'm pretty sure you guys know what a rocket stove is, or you've heard of a rocket stove. So we'll get into that for a moment. Oh man, says Red. All right, so our concept starts out with a basic rocket stove design. And we're going to do a little modification to it. Let me get a screen share and show you what I'm thinking of. The nuts have bolted. All right. Let me go to sharing this thing here. All right, there we go. Okay, so we know what a basic rocket stove is. I'm going to not install the latest update. Let's see if I can draw a shape. Let's see. How about a line? There we go. We'll do brush width 60. All right. All right, let me see here. Well, that looks horrible. Let me back this up here. All right, so your basic shape for one of these stoves is a, really? My mouse doesn't want to cooperate with me. Your basic shape is kind of a J shape. For the people who have never seen a rocket stove before, I know. The two or three that are actually out there. I'll just do a quick brief sketch of what one looks like from the side, and then we'll get into it. All right. Okay, that's a basic J shape that a rocket stove would look like. Let me back up here. And all right. Vicky's asking if after 2 years storage with the nuts still be viable if planted. Possibly. Depends. Not always, but sometimes, yes. All right, so that's a J. It looks like a J. Amazing, it looks like a J. All right, so the idea behind the rocket stove, go ahead and get a full screen here. And hopefully you can see the little mouse pointer thingamajig here. All right, got my mouse pointer here. The idea behind the rocket stove is you take your fuel and you put it down in the top. Imagine this is like a pipe right here, all right? A J-shaped pipe. Put your fuel into the top, so your fuel's sitting in here. And you get it lit. It's going to burn inside this tunnel here. And some people put the feed in at an angle. It's all open where the fuel goes in. So you have a lot of airflow coming in. A lot of airflow coming in means that the fire is well fed, and as the smoke, which contains your wood gas, which is also flammable vapors, rises up in this chimney column here, the heat and the airflow is sufficient to cause it to also combust, making it shoot out a jet of fire as far up as it can, burning all of the fuel and all the flammable vapors and leaving very little smoke and producing a lot of heat in this chimney column. If you guys have ever had a wood stove and your wood stove has had a fire in the chimney and you hear that roaring sound, well, that's the kind of sound a rocket stove makes intentionally. So you're not going to use lightweight stovepipe for this chimney area. Use heavier materials, heavy steel pipe, or even masonry brick, fire brick, that sort of thing, to build this sort of contraption. Now, this isn't exactly what I'm building, but that's the basic design that you'll find at places like permies.com whenever you go and look at that sort of thing. All right. And it doesn't hurt that it's got a J shape. All right. John Pumphrey's in here saying hello. Dragonfire. Well, yeah, there's also the dragon stove, the dragon rocket stove. There's various designs and various improved designs. We'll get into that in a second. We wanted to start out with a rocket stove as the basic core of the project and then build on to that. And some of this stuff, I don't know. Uh-oh, they're coming to get me. Nah, that's the fire department. Oh, no, they're coming to get me. All right, we wanted to start out with a basic rocket stove design and move on from there. You can make your rocket stove out of anything, really. You can make it out of clay. You have an adobe-fired oven. I kind of like that concept. All right, let me reduce my brush width from super wide to narrow again. And we will build a bit different design for a rocket stove. All right, we're going to start with intake. And I'm going to draw this at about a 45 degree angle. This is not going to be incredibly precise, but it'll be close. All right, intake 45 degree angle. Then we're going to do another one, also at a 45. Approximately. There we go. All right, and let me zoom in here. Look at that, I can zoom. I pull this in a little bit more. All right. And lo and behold, it's become something like a pipe. Can always finish this off with the pencil. What do you think? There we go. All right. So now we have the pipe coming in. This is nowhere close to being a scale model, just so you know. All right. The line up there, and then we're going to erase my excess down here. This is easier to do it this way. All right, so you have to have something coming in to load your stove with. Next, you're going to need the burn tunnel. I'm going to do this with a line and zoom in. So down here, we're going to build a burn tunnel. burn tunnel. Okay, that's nice. Let's undo that actually. Come out here a little bit. Let me zoom out a little bit. So all right. And I want this to be almost perfect. Oh, I had it for a second there. All right. So here's a burn tunnel. All right. And we're going to do another line here. Same thing. That's pretty close. And at the far end, the burn tunnel. I probably made that a little bit longer than it needs to be. So we'll cut the rest of it off. We have our, let me zoom out here. Or zoom out some more. We have our column come up at the top. And this would be our chimney. But it's not like a stovepipe chimney. This is a thick-walled pipe, thick-walled iron pipe, or some kind of masonry that can handle the heat. Okay. Remove our excesses. And we'll go to pencil and finish off here. Dot, 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 dot. The dots indicate that this is actually open on the inside, but from the outside, you'd see a welded seam there. All right. And I'm just going to take out this entire spot here, except for a little dot, 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 dot. Welded seam here too. All right. So let's back up. Now we have a little bit different view of your rocket stove model with an angled pipe coming in instead of a pipe going straight up and down. I kind of liked that concept. It made sense to me anyway. There we go. Probably be easier to just draw an ellipse like that for the top. But you have something that looks a bit like that. Let's see if you can see it on the screen. Yeah, a bit like that. All right, now imagine this thing here is made, put my pointer on it. Imagine this thing here is made, where'd it go? There you go. Imagine this is made with iron pipe, all iron pipe. And this is the core of your furnace. In an ordinary furnace, you would have a door here. You wouldn't have this pipe coming down. You'd have a door here. You'd have your firebox, which would be a bit bigger. And then you'd have your chimney coming out, and you would be heating up this space here around the firebox and losing a bunch of heat off of your chimney, unless, of course, your chimney ran the length of your house, and then you'd be able to capture some of that heat. A rocket stove works a little bit differently in that you don't want to get too close to this chimney area, because it's going to get really hot. And this is actually where most of your heat is generated, is where this chimney part is. Of course, if you're using it as a stove that you're cooking on, you might have a burner up here at the top, which is typically the way you see them. Let me see. Lisa's here. Joe's here. Let me see here. Old car manifold. There you go. You can build these out of scrap parts. I mean, it's really not complicated. You just don't want your metal pipe to be too thin, because it is going to get hot. You don't want to make it warp or melt. Red's asking what the blueprints are on the pick. I have no idea. I just found a picture that has some random blueprints on there and slapped them up there. Vicky's talking about the Dakota Fire underground rocket stove, stealthy and efficient. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Good for cooking on, and of course, using that big chimney area, the big iron pipe, you produce a lot of heat. So if you're warming yourself up with, you have that indoors to heat yourself with, but you might not want to have your source of heat directly in the house. What if you could get your heat generated outside and bring the heat into the house? Well, that's what this next modification to the rocket stove is. And I'm pretty sure I've seen some plans for it before. Oh, incidentally, we've got Veteran Ironwood in the house with us tonight. If everybody say hello to Veteran Ironwood. I'm going to go and grab his, unless somebody else can beat me to it, get his... the link for his channel and put it up there, because they are really, really close to that 1,000 mark. And I always thought it would be a good idea to support our blacksmiths, considering the day may come that we actually really need somebody that can weld steel and iron with a basic forge. And of course, they can do a lot more than that. Your basic tool making needs a blacksmith. All right. Got it. Let's see. I'm gonna type in, yeah, I can't spell. But currently they're at 956 last time I checked. 956 subscribers. Almost there. Almost there. Really, really close. Really close. All right. Brian's saying, so you can dry peanuts on your stove, assuming you can grow peanuts in Minnesota. Right. That might be hard. That might be really hard. All right. So the modification that you usually see on your rocket stove would be something like this. You're gonna have, hang on a second, before I even get there. Something every rocket stove should have. All right, let me find my pencil and we're gonna zoom in tight. And I'm just gonna go ahead and knock these holes here so that you know that we have a grate at the bottom of the burn tunnel and here where we feed at. The mesh on the grate's gotta be slightly smaller than the smallest particle size of fuel that you're gonna put in. And since rocket stoves are great at this particular function, they can burn smaller pieces of fuel than you would put into a regular wood stove. You feed your fuel in here, it's going to land here, it'll catch on fire, it'll burn. The airflow will pull the fire this way. Let me go ahead and grab an arrow. That's right. You're going to pull your fire this way. All right. Draw another arrow here for fuel and airflow. Text on the screen. There you go. Fuel and air. All right. Air flows this way. Okay, primary combustion takes place here. And since the air is always flowing this way, whenever you get to this point, let me draw another arrow here. You see that? All right. Okay, text here. Primary. Primary combustion takes place here. And up here, we have our secondary. Combustion is our flammable gases that are released whenever your wood fuel is burning you down here in the primary combustion chamber. All right, let me zoom out. There we go. And you select. All right, that's looking more like a schematic, right? Okay, so here we go. Fuel and air come in through here. They ignite here. There's a grate here where their ashes are going to fall down. I'll show where they fall down here in a second. As the heat and the gases that are produced by the combustion, which includes your smoke, get to this column here, those also catch on fire because you have the massive volume of airflow coming through, and they continue to burn until they're completely burned up inside this column, which is not a thin-walled chimney pipe. It's thick iron pipe, or you can use some sort of good insulating material. But for the design I have in mind, you want iron pipe, unless you've got somebody that can work with copper, which might even be better. All right. Now, let's put a couple more things on our design. Zoom in down here. Actually, you don't need to look at me. Let's go ahead and get this thing up here. All right. So I mentioned we have little grates at the bottom where our ash can fall. Unless, of course, you want to get in there and manually clean out the ashes all the time. But I'm going to go ahead and carry that grate all the way to the back here. Because amazingly enough, even though at this point everything is going to be gaseous, there may actually be some physical particles that will still wind up settling down here. All right. Let's get my little drawing tool and draw a line that's as close to 90 degrees as I can get. There we, oh, wow, that's exactly 90 degrees. That'll work. All right. I'm going to draw another one just like it. Or close to it. All right, there we go. And let me zoom out. I'm going to grab this and bring it over here to the other side. Okay. And then we'll do one across the bottom. Make sure they're coming together nicely. That looks good. Okay. And so we don't get confused about what's what. Arrow. That's a big arrow, isn't it? Let's do a smaller arrow. Oh, yeah. Let's do a smaller arrow. That's just silly. Tell you what. Oh, let's go for it. Let me change that. Let's cut this out and put it there. There. Now we know that. Now we know what that part's supposed to be. There we go. That's better. All right. Okay, so this box down here is where we're going to catch our ashes. That's why I had to move that airflow up to the other side. This is our ash bin. Okay. And we might want to make it with a little door. There's a little funky doorknob or something. A little door, a little knob. I don't know if that looks like a knob or not. There we go. We have a little door, a little knob, so we can reach in there and clear out our ashes. That just looks dorky. There we go. Let's try this. All right, there we go. That looks more like a little latch on a hinged door that opens up. So we catch our ashes down in here. You can also have additional airflow in where your ashes are being collected. That helps as well. If you're using something like hardwood pellets for your fuel, the grate here would have to be fine enough that the pellets don't fall through it. They just drop down whenever they get to be ashes. You open up the door to the ash bin, reach in there with your shovel, pull the ashes out, and you're good to go. All right, you still have to worry about this area up here, which is what we're getting ready to examine. Let's see. The way I usually see this done, somebody will have something like a 55-gallon drum that they surround the pipe with up here. You can use a 55-gallon drum for the shroud surrounding your stove. You wouldn't want to use that for that combustion chamber, the secondary combustion chamber, because 55-gallon drum might not quite be strong enough to take the heat. All right. Draw my line down here. We're going to build a shroud. Make sure that let's go 90 degrees or as close to it as I can get. There we go. And connect. That looks good. All right. And because I'm crazy, I'm just going to come down here and I'll just copy that line and move it over to the side and put it on the other side. There we go. Move this line down to here. Well, I guess if you wanted to, let's see. All right. There, I think. All right, and then we're going to do one more line. Bring that to there. Okay. All right. Yeah, that's starting to look like it. I'm going to draw. So you go with an ellipse, a narrow ellipse. We're going to draw a little. Top there. All right. Yeah. Now we're starting to look like a basic mass heater sort of rocket stove design. All right. Hang on just a second here. Ta-da. Oh, you guys have been talking up a storm. Salty moonshiners' penis are easy. Right. Yeah, the problem is you need to get your air hot and dry. That's the thing. And yeah, Veteran Ironwood's got the right idea. What we're wanting to do is build this shroud here around the secondary combustion pipe. This is your exhaust. This is the part where most of your heat happens. It gets really, really hot right here. And if you made this out of iron pipe, then you would have the opportunity to capture this in some sort of a shroud right here. Now, the idea that we're going to have for this is, let me zoom in. Let me put a spot of text here. This is going to be a jacket. Air jacket surrounding the stove, and up here, let me draw another line that connects here. We're going to have a couple of them. We'll bring out to here. Of course, lines indicate that this connects on the outside, and then we're going to draw our ellipse like so. All right, and we'll label this one air out because that's what it is, and we'll put a arrow indicating our direction. Like so. All right, and we're going to do another arrow here. Just a little skinny one. Oh, shoot. There we go. Get this thing to tilt up. There we go. All right. And this is our exhaust. All right. Not done, because someplace we're going to need a place to bring in cool air, right? Now, there's a couple places where you could do it, but probably you want it to come in someplace that's not next to the primary combustion chamber or next to the fuel and air intake. So we'll take it over here where we're going to get our normal temperature air inlet. So we got a couple more lines down here. And we'll just put that out like so. So draw our ellipse so it actually looks like a pipe. And draw our arrow, not right there, up. Tell you what, my mouse pointer is not being cooperative. All right. Arrow, that's a convincing looking arrow. Let's rotate it around like so, and that's our dry air inlet. All right, zoom out and see what we got. Oh my gosh, it's starting to look an awful lot more like a rocket stove here. All right. Get this centered like so, and then we can zoom in to see the entire thing, hopefully. Like that. There we go. There we go. All right, so that's starting to look like a rocket stove. I've got one more thing that we got to do to it. And this is the place where having a friend who's good with welding or a friend that's got a forge or a blacksmith shop would come in handy, because you can probably guess what the problem is with this basic design. Let's see. Yeah, gotta have your air dried. Fortunately, wood heat dries air really good. Everybody's talking. Vicky's asking, does anyone have good recommendations on where to get distilling equipment for potables or distillation used for everything, water, alcohol, to essential oils? I really need to go and find a good source for an essential oil still, at the very least an essential oil still. I wouldn't mind having the other kind for distilling alcohol, for making tinctures and stuff like that as well. But definitely for being able to get my essential oils, because those are, you know, medicine. Well, and yeah. You know, distilling for tinctures too. It's obviously medicinal. Vicky's saying, depending upon what the fuel is, the ashes can be used for many purposes. Yeah, preferably if you're using wood heat for anything, use hardwood. That way you have hardwood ashes that you can use. You can use a little bit of resinous wood for getting your fire started, but don't burn resinous wood. So cedar, pine, don't burn it for fuel if you can help it. It'll build up creosote and cause you to have a chimney fire. Of course, if you're using a rocket stove, that doesn't really matter too much. The idea was to combust everything entirely in the first place. Add a copper pipe to your pressure cooker. Yeah, if you've got a coil that you can come out of your copper pipe with to act as your worm, then yeah, you can use a pressure cooker for a basic distillation unit. Very, 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 very basic. Yeah, it doesn't hurt going and looking at Lead Farmer 73's videos either. He's very good at taking things and really uncomplicating them. Brian's making me hungry talking about smoked ham bones and pea soup with cheddar. Oh, that sounds good. Let's see. Why don't I build a smoker? Because I don't want a smoker. I want something else. All right. Vicky's saying, if you substitute water for air, you can use hot water. Okay, now the problem that you have is, how do you get the hot air and hot water to circulate? And we're getting ready to get to that. Let me open up a new page, actually. Let's see here. File, new. No, that doesn't seem right. Hang on, let's cancel that. Let me see. File. Select all. Okay. File. New. There we go. There we go. Now I've got a new file. Same size. Double check and make sure that I've got the new picture in. No, I don't. I don't have the new picture in. Let's see here. All right. So if I've got this picture selected. Okay, there we go. Mary says her dream house has heated floors. You see what I have to work with here, guys? She wants heated floors. Well, I don't want to send a fire underneath the floor, so I need to find a way to get hot air under the floor and not have it make contact with the fire. So that's what this is. We've got the jacket all the way around. It's closed at the top, closed at the bottom. It only has an inlet here for air to come in, inlet here for the hot air to come out. But let me go ahead and, while I'm still here on this area, I'm going to go draw my circle. I want the circle to be about the size of that pipe there. There we go. That's close. And then we're going to make this one about the size of this pipe. It's not going to be perfect, guys. I mean, I could probably if we wanted to spend all day working on it, but we just want to get the rough hack out here. All right. So let me print this up here. Air jacket and secondary combustion chamber. Top view. All right. Double check to make sure everybody can see what we're doing here. Okay. Yep. It shows. All right. So now we got a top view of our air jacket and secondary combustion chamber. And what we're going to put all up and down. Our thick-walled iron pipe here are these, and I'm going to tilt them just ever so slightly, clockwise or counterclockwise, depending upon whether I'm in the northern hemisphere or the southern hemisphere, because we're going to make these vanes serve two functions for us. The vanes will be made out of metal too. If we're using iron pipe here, we're going to use iron for the vanes. Very, very thin iron. So that as that pipe gets hot, these vanes will radiate the heat out into the jacket. Much like the vanes on your radiator in your car, or the little tiny vanes that you see on your air conditioner, serve the same purpose, which is to ever so slightly, and I want this to go ever so slightly that way. The vanes' purpose is to provide lots of surface area to disperse heat. So we want to get as much heat out of that iron pipe from the secondary combustion chamber into this air jacket as we possibly can get. And we can keep on going here if you want and keep on adding. Oh, hello. Keep on adding more vanes and more vanes and more vanes and more vanes until this entire area is just packed full of these vanes, which don't go all the way out to this jacket. They can be tack welded at various points as long as there's enough room around the outside for the airflow to flow around them. And so far, we're still within the realm of being able to build this sort of a contraption using a basic forge with a few tools. This is actually the one thing that I don't think I've seen on any of the designs for a rocket stove to this point. All right. Let's go find a arrow. Make it skinny. Actually, I think I probably want to move it to there. All right, then text. Things here. Like so. All right. Now we've got a better idea what this looks like on the inside. So we have these vanes inside here. Let me do maybe a little concept art on the inside. We don't want them to come all the way out to the edge. And we don't want them to completely abstract. You could do fun things like, actually, that's a great idea. Let's do it this way. And bring these veins down, oh, almost all the way. And then like this. Okay. Yeah, I think this would be actually better. Give me a second here to correct my faux pas. I'm just going to show this on one side. Just on one side. Let me do that. Filled shape. All right. So you can. These are not going to be just size. No particular reason why I'm doing this particular pattern. It's just seemed fun. We're just going to do little holes through the veins. To allow the air to flow through them. Because you don't want to impede your airflow. All right. There we go. Okay. How's it look now? There we go. All right. Yeah, you could use metal fan blades for those veins on the inside. I mean, found materials are great. If you find exactly the parts you're looking for, you can throw them together with a welder. Then you're doing good. But here's the idea. Fuel and air come in through here. They hit this grate right up here where their combusted airflow causes the fire to move this way. Fire comes up into our secondary combustion chamber, which is thick-walled iron pipe, where it continues to burn until we reach our exhaust here at the top, where there is usually no smoke left. We've burned up all the smoke by the time we get up here to the exhaust. Meanwhile, our air jacket completely surrounds our secondary combustion chamber. It has thin metal veins attached to that thick-walled iron pipe in the center where our combustion chamber is, holes in those veins so the air can flow completely and totally around them. We have our air coming in at the bottom where it is cooler, and of course coming out at the top where it is hot, heated by the secondary combustion chamber and these veins. Meanwhile, our exhaust from the fuel burning process goes out to wherever it's going to go from. I've got an idea where that's going to be, which I'll show you when we get to this next picture. Here we go. Here's the next picture where we start out with a pipe coming in, which we probably don't want to be that big. All right, undo. Undo. There we go. All right, we're going to start with, say, a 2. There we go. That's good. All right, so pipe coming in. All right. And there's an ellipse. We don't want to fill it in, just the outline. All right, so here's a pipe coming in. checks. And this is hot air in. Air going in. We're going to have yet another chamber. Actually, you know what I need to do? I need to move this down. Let's do that real quick. Move this down to the bottom of the screen. Otherwise, I'm going to run out of room, and it's going to be silly, and people wonder what in the heck I'm up to. All right. Okay, there we go. Fire coming in down here. It's coming in. To our device. All right. Get as close to being level as possible there. All right. And that's pretty close to a 90 degree. All right, so here's our box. Oh, that's 91. There's 90. All right, and we were using ellipse here. All right. There we go. Okay. Almost there. All right, and here's a hard air coming in. Of course, little dotted line to indicate that that's an air intake. We got a direction of hot air in. And then up here, magic of magic, we're gonna put a couple pipes here at 90, or a couple lines here at 90 degree angles, or close to it. And our ellipse. With an arrow. Okay. Somehow I managed to. Oh, I didn't deselect after I drew the ellipse. That's what I did. There we go. All right. Text here. And this one is going to be our. Roaster exhaust. And try to zoom out. There we go. All right, so we have hot air coming in from here. Here's our hot air out. It goes here. Hot air into this device, which is our roaster, with exhaust coming out the top. And we'll draw our little door here. Maybe do about there. And bring this over to here. Close to 90. Ooh. Well, that's close enough for me. Right about there. Then we'll do the bottom of the door. Okay, and so you know it was a door and not something weird. We're gonna do that little. That looks horrible. I'm sorry, that looks horrible. Hang on a second. I'm sure I can have a convincing looking handle than that. Hang on. Let's just go zoom in here. Yeah, draw a line. Okay, and then draw another little line. Latch there. Of course, your hinges and latches don't have to be like this. Hinges for your door. You want this door to fit as flush as possible and as tight as possible, by the way. Because if at all possible, you want this chamber, your roasting chamber, which we may as well label as such. Your roasting chamber be as well sealed as possible. Now, inside of it, we'll have, let me get a quick copy of it. No, I wanted you to move out here. There you go. All right. Looking about like this. All right. Then we're going to. All right. Inside, we're going to have. I need to actually. Erase some stuff real quick. Let me get this up to 5. All right, we're going to do a cutaway. Sometimes. Oh, my outdoor lights just came on. If you guys are watching Marius Tulsa Fox's channel, she did a video upload, I think yesterday or the day before, on the outdoor lights. I'll have the full setup video out sometime. Sometime maybe this year. I don't know when I'm going to get it out. All right, so we know where the door is. It's about there. So starting just above that door. Oh, hello. That's a healthy looking. It's a healthy looking line. Let me reduce the size of that one just a touch. Oh yeah, because it's brush width 5. All right, so we're gonna have a shelf here. You can come up a little bit. Another shelf. And in theory, as many shelves as you can pack in here. I'm showing 4. All right. But you can really have as many shelves as you can stick in here, really. Let's draw an arrow. And continue to rotate that arrow. There you go. Drawing shelves right there. Okay, so here we go. And operation, whenever you're working your roaster dehydrator, you open up the door here, you lay your trays of whatever you're roasting or dehydrating on the shelves inside. We've got our hot air coming in, roaster exhaust coming out. And at this point, if you wanted to, you could pretty much be done. All you need is a fan to keep the air circulating. But what if you don't have electricity and you don't have a fan? All right, here's where we get to the fun part. Remember, we have our hot air coming in. We have our roaster exhaust coming out. We also can have, and here's where we get creative. I'm going to draw a couple of parallel lines. We're going to make a Y. Really come together, and hopefully it's, yeah, my angle's horrible. Let me fix that angle. That's better. Okay, I have a Y coming in here, and we're going to go ahead and finish drawing our lines. Give me a second here so I can see what I'm doing. As close to 90 degrees as possible. There we go. And because, let's just draw the little end of the pipe here. I'm going to need a pencil. There we go. All right. So we're going to draw a couple arrows real quick. And then I'll add the text to it, and you'll see what I just did. All right. So. All right, here's our airflow from the roaster as it comes out. And we could always go dot, 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 dot. Yeah, you know, sort of do a little dotted line here so we know that these are connected. All right. That's a horrible dotted line. Sorry about that. I took a drafting class in high school. The shop teacher said I should find another line of work. Okay. So now we're going to go with text. Put this on the screen. This is our hot air. Hot air from mass heater. Right here, coming in. Sorry, I lie. That is not hot air from mass heater. That is the exhaust from the mass heater, the part that's coming out the top of your secondary combustion chamber. Here we have combined exhaust of both coming together. And let's zoom out here. And now when we put these two together, we have this one, exhaust coming out, hot air going out, and this one, hot air coming in. And we have the exhaust combining with our exhaust out of the roaster, which creates pressure drawing the air through the roasting compartment. Ta-da! Fun, fun, fun. Now, if you feed it a lot, you're going to produce a lot of hot air, and you're going to produce a forced convection heating of whatever's in that roaster compartment. And in that case, it's going to work exactly like using your hot air fryer, your electric hot air fryer back at home that you might already have one. We have two. So we can actually cook two turkeys at once and not even be home. The air fryers are a wonderful invention. So we've managed to take the exhaust out of our mass heater at the top of that secondary combustion chamber and bring it together with the exhaust coming out of our roasting compartment, which is just being fed with the hot air, and use that exhaust to create the draw that pulls the hot air through the roasting compartment. So no fan, no electricity. We just feed it fire, or feed it fuel, and the fire creates that forced air that we needed to create the dehydrating or cooking effect. So if you feed it a little bit, if we use a little fire and just feed a little bit, we have a nice flow of dry, warm air running through. That's dehydration. It'll work whenever it's cloudy. It'll work whenever it's rainy. It'll work anytime that you couldn't use a solar dehydrator, and especially it'll work whenever you don't have any electricity. Chris's Clevercraft is knocking on the door saying, knock, knock, knock. Now there's a couple other different things that you can use this concept for, and I'll get into those in just a moment. Let me see here. Oh my goodness, it's almost 8:30. I've been on for an hour and a half. Wow. Let me catch up with my chat real quick, and I'll talk really fast about some of the other applications for this concept. Vicky's telling me I could use a handicap door handle. Sun ovens are awesome, by the way. If you haven't seen them before, a solar oven, awesome, awesome, awesome. But of course, you have to have them sunshine to make them work. Ta-da. Mary says, if anyone builds this thingy, send pictures. Well, yeah, send pictures of your version of it. I am going to build one of these in the future. I've made up my mind. I am going to build one. Ta-da. Of course, this is not drawn to any particular scale, so scale it up to however big you can make it. All right. Wow. I'm way behind in comments. Did Deep South Homestead drop in here? Oh, no. Vicky was talking about Deep South. Okay. Yeah. Deep South Homestead has some really interesting stuff on smokers. I just saw Deep South. One. What? Are they here? Okay. So Mary is saying that's how they heat their homes in Wisconsin. Like an old school. Okay, so yeah, way up in the frozen north, you may notice that the furnace is not actually necessarily in the house. I like this concept because this means that your fire is not in your house, which means if there's some sort of an accident and something happens, your house doesn't burn down. The only thing going into your house was hot air. In this particular case where we're using the... this roaster compartment, the only thing going into the roaster compartment is hot air, which was coming out from around that jacket that surrounds your secondary combustion chamber. So you can do all of your burning, all of your combustion, all of your production of carbon monoxide completely and totally separated from your living quarters or wherever else you're working. There is no byproducts from combustion at all that will be coming out of this hot air out. It is just going to be hot air. And it'll be really, really hot because we've got all of these vanes connected to that iron pipe in the center of your combustion chamber, little perforation zones so the air flows through them really, really nice. And that means superheated air going into your roasting chamber or dehydration chamber, depending upon how much fuel you're using. If you're using a little bit, you're dehydrating. If you're using a lot, you're roasting. But you should be able to get very, very hot temperatures inside this chamber. All right. That's the concept or the idea here. Brian's saying, drive up here in December. You can have all the ham and pea soup you want and movies. Oh, yeah. I like ham and pea soup. All right. Vicky's saying run the plumbing according for convection. Hot air rises hot water or hot air will come to the top, cold water comes down. Basement water radiator heaters were common a century ago. Yeah, they were, and they do still use them. even with wood heat, coal heat, whatever kind of heat you can use. I guess another advantage of this design, since you have your combustion area separate from where the heat comes out, if you are using some sort of unconventional fuel that doesn't necessarily smell good, doesn't matter, because it's not, your exhaust is not going into the house at all. You're just getting hot air into the house. If you're using this to heat your house, you could always, let me go ahead and get back to here. Can I have a new file right here? Oh, no, we don't want that one. Let's select all. There we go. Now let's try a new file. Okay, that looks better. All right, so Mary had to bring up, she wanted heated floors. All right, that's fine. Mary can have her heated floors. Let's draw Mary's house for her real quick. All right, Mary, here's your house. Your house is not going to look like this, by the way. Here's your house. I'm going to make a box. There you go. All right, now you know why the door doesn't hang right. See, the house isn't quite square. You got your house. You've got your house is sitting on top of, you guessed it, foundations. This is going to be horribly not to scale and definitely not square. All right. And then because there we go. All right, that looks like a house. But now we can draw our little arrow here. All right. We can put hot air in and circulate it underneath the floorboards if you want to, right? That's fun. All right. That's it. How's it work? The good part. All right. Scandinavian windows, water circulating. Yeah. Yeah, fun stuff. And there's a whole bunch of different things you can do here. Lisa's asking, is anybody successfully heated with compost? If you're interested in compost heating experiments, I know you watch Sean's channel, Edible Acres. He does a lot of those. So varying degrees of success. I think so far it's better than nothing, but not as good as having a wood stove or some other form of heat. But it is better than nothing. Space goes fast. It sure does. So, air intake. And so your intake on your house can come in here and circulate your hot air under your floors if you like. But I was thinking about something else. Let me draw. Don't tell anybody this is supposed to be the ground. See, this is exactly why your house doesn't work properly. It's because the ground's not level. It's at an angle. The doors aren't hung right. Probably you had Jason come in and do the and do the work, because Jason is not a great carpenter, just so you know. All right, so here we go. Really quick here. This is obviously not going to be to scale. I'm just going to draw a series of circles here. And they're not going to be to scale either. And no, here we go. Really? I just wanted to move it to the side. I didn't want to like change its proportions or anything. All right. That's going to look weird. I guess I could do it with a brush. All right, here we go. This is going to look horrible. I'm going to just make it look like a child's drawing because I'm in a hurry now. All right, so let's stop that. Let's stop that. All right. Let me... Not that. Okay. Let me just stipulate that we have something that looks like there we go. There we go. Coils. Since I don't want to go to the trouble of actually trying to draw the coils out right now. Coils underground. Let's get a line coming up here. Line coming up here. That's probably horrible. All right. And draw. Something that sort of looks like what I'm trying to draw here. Very, very coarse looking. All right, so we got a gooseneck coming here. All right, so goosenecks here at the ground level. This keeps water from coming in here. This gooseneck going into your coils underground can have your HEPA filter on it, stopping dust and mold spores from getting down into your coils underground. This might be good for another show, or just should probably really do this properly. And coming up into your house, of course, you've got, so you don't want hot air. By golly, you want cold air. And that arrow doesn't look like an arrow. You want cold air, so fine. Here we go. And let's change our scale. Let's go 20. Really? Must be text right here. There we go. Do another error here. And air intake on the surface. Shrink that text so you don't get it confused with the hot air in on this side of the diagram. All right, so air intake goes in here, goes through that gooseneck so you don't get water in it. You're still going to have water vapor in here, by the way. So you go down here to your coils underground. That's at least 5 foot down, probably 10 to 15 foot to be on the safe side, where you have a constant ground temperature of about 55 degrees, which means the air coming out will be cool, right? Yes, yes. But for this, you don't have your hot air going in here. You have your hot air coming in up here. And that just looks horrible. do a quick little chimney stack up here. If I can. Okay, I remember a while back I was talking about using a passive system to provide cooling for the house, where you would have your vent up here. Where your chimney coming out the top of the house being painted black, as long as the sun's shining, is going to absorb a lot of heat, which will create airflow, drawing your cool air up from underneath. But this is based upon the idea that you're going to have sunshine. What if you have a hot, muggy, nasty day? And the sun isn't shining. So you don't get that extra heat on your chimney at the top. And as a result, it never gets to the point where it'll actually start drying that cool air in. Well, that's a problem with your passive system. You might want to add a power source. And as it happens, we've just figured out a potential power source that we can have come in and join. Wow, that brush didn't, that line didn't draw very well, did it? All right. So we would have our get in here. First dotted line, so we know that this is not a solid wall. An arrow, because we like drawing arrows. There we go. And then we can put, really? That text? Hot air. Hot air coming from our mass heater, which is not inside the house. It is instead outside the house, and this is what happens. All right. Back here at the hot air here at the mass heater, we've got our fuel going in, our air going in. Primary combustion happens, comes here. Gas, the combustible gases get to the secondary burner. They burn up here. Our exhaust comes out the top. It heats up air here. But what if you do not have your hot air or your exhaust connected to your roaster or dehydrator, but instead you have it connected close to that peak where your chimney is up here? Well, in this case, the hot air coming in here is going to produce the draw that you need to pull your cool air in through your geothermal coil. So you actually have a wood-fired air conditioner. There's one little problem with this design, and I didn't cover it the other day when I was talking about these, so I'm going to just really quick draw a little something. All the way down here underneath your coil, all the way down under here, below everything else, we're going to try to draw a straight line. So, all right. Down here where our coils are at the low point, we want a connection to a chamber beneath, which we're going to call our sump. And at the bottom of our sump, we're going to want to put, really? Can I get my line to come straight? I'm going to put another another pipe. It doesn't have to be positioned outside the house. It could be inside if you want. All right. And for the sake of convenience, I'm just going to do a little quick doodle here and call this our pump. Could be either, really? There we go. This could either be a hand pump or an electric pump to draw the water out of this sump down here. Because as you draw air in from the outside, cool it with the 55 degree heat gradient underground. If there's moisture in it, that will condense. You want that to flow from the low point of your coils into your sump. So you gather fresh, clean water down here at the sump because you've already passed it through an air filter on the way in, right? You didn't want any dust or mold spores getting into it. Well, no dust, no mold spores. You've got nice, cool, clean air coming up into your house, and you've got nice, fresh, clean, and cool water collecting in the sump down below, which you can pump out whenever you're thirsty or whenever you need to water your garden. And this can also be powered by your furnace outside. La la. All right. Let me get back to just a regular screen and look at you guys. So that's the idea, the basic idea. So you have one little device, this mass heater, a rocket stove. You could set it up to actually run off of that wood pellet fuel if you want to, or small scraps, your coppice wood from your hazelnut trees. I bet you guys are planting hazelnut trees, right? All right. And you can coppice those back every 9 years or so. Go do them in rotation, so you always have one that's fully mature, and you always have some that you're coppicing. That's your small pieces of firewood that you can feed into that mass heater. Whoosh, rocket stove. That jet exhaust can be used to draw cool air from your geothermal coils underneath your house or your greenhouse or your other space to keep the area cool. So you have a whole bunch of different applications to that one simple tool that you're using for a variety of different purposes. You can use it to heat your home, have nice warm heated floors the way Mary would like. You could use it to help keep your home cool using geothermal coils underneath. You could use it for roasting your peanuts or your other nuts. If you have hazels and pecans and oaks and like we do, then that's perfect for roasting your nuts. And you can also use it in the case of emergency for dehydrating food, like your tomatoes, whenever you grew way too many and you couldn't eat them all and you don't feel like canning them. Besides which, where are you going to get the canning lids anyway? All right. Oh yeah, Lisa. I've got one of them planted so far, and I'm making sure at least one of them stays indoors with me. So we're going to make sure that one way or another, that fig tree stays alive. And Grace is just going to have to be upset because the tree never died. It just moved and then multiplied. Space does go fast, especially with homesteading and preparedness gear. Yep. Gear takes up a lot of space. One of the reasons why when Mary starts talking about small homes, I'm like, where are you going to put all your stuff? Where are you going to put all your cans? Where's the food? Where's the tools? Where's everything? Let's see. No, Mary, I don't think the cat's going to eat the fig tree. I don't think she'll like it. She might nibble on it a little bit. Maybe. A little bit. Yeah. Vicky's saying, before Prohibition, stills were common equipment on farms and homestead. Alcohol has many uses. Hey, by the way, while we're talking about that, I mean, this is not specifically this conversation, but hang on a second. I've got a book over here. Oy, on the bookshelf. Let me see. Oh. Right here. It's from an author called David Bloom. It is called Alcohol Can Be a Gas. So here is your instruction manual for doing all kinds of interesting things like building stills and You got your temperature conversion charts and other fun stuff in here, so you can use that information for doing your basic steel construction. Having books like this in hard copy is a wonderful thing to have around, just in case for some reason you can't use the internet anymore. Hard copy, it's king, folks. Brian, what quantity of peanuts are we talking? I don't know. I'm thinking about planting a lot more peanuts next year, so maybe about 1/24 of an acre. If they all turn out, that's enough calories to feed a person for about 125 days altogether. So bigger next year than this year. But they make a really good ground cover. I've been very happy with them as a ground cover. Hello, Chris Clevercraft. I'm sorry, Brian. Living in Wisconsin, your opportunities to marry a bikini model are going to be—they're going to be somewhat limited. Mary is a plus-size bikini model. Well, especially in Wisconsin, Brian. I lived up there for a while too. It's you gotta put a little extra padding on, otherwise you won't make it through the winter. Lisa says, this looks cool and all, but I think I'm gonna stick to using my sun oven to dehydrate. Nothing wrong with sun ovens and solar dehydrators. Let's see. Yeah, there's ads for sun ovens, and there's a homesteading couple off in Missouri that features them and shows them off on a fairly regular basis. I think you can order them using an affiliate link from those two. The couple of Missouri, the two homesteaders in Missouri, the girl wears a cowboy hat it's a straw cowboy hat. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? I can't recall their names off the top of my head. I'm sorry. But I know I've seen them present solar ovens before. And I'm pretty sure they've got an affiliate link if you're interested in those. It'll come to me as soon as we're done with the show. I'll remember who it was. Brian says, I just wish you was teaching me how to make moonshine. One of these days, maybe. One of these days. So the mass heater, once you've got this thing set up and it's outside and it's not directly connected to the house, you have the option of where you want to hook those ducts to. You could have your hot air out going to the roaster dehydrator, that sort of thing. You could have your hot air out going out to your house as sub heat for your floor. You can have the hot air going out to the top of your chimney at the top of your house to provide the necessary draw to power your passive cooling on days whenever you don't have sun. So there's all different applications to that. Of course, you could also have it circulating water, running a boiler, generating steam, turning a turbine to make electricity for you if you want to, too. There's any number of different things that you can do with this sort of setup once you've got it established and make a regular permanent fixture. I really want to do a lot of experimenting with it and some tinkering. I might do a couple small models or something over the winter if I can talk Mary into letting me get the materials. We'll see. We'll see what she'll let me play with. Let's see. Let's see. Yeah, my dad jokes don't go over your head, though. All right. Yeah, springs on the futons don't last really well. But I think we got a few years out of it before it just started to get a little bit too squishy. Doug and Stacy, thank you, Lisa. That's who it is, Doug and Stacy. Yep. But buy direct because they don't need any help. You never know. You never know. I haven't watched a Doug and Stacy video in a good long minute. Alrighty, guys. We are at almost 9 o'clock. I've been here 2 hours, which is an hour longer than I anticipated doing, but I kind of got sidetracked. Fortunately, the first half, we got the basics of here's a rocket mass heater, here's the thing that you can do with it immediately, and then everything else is just sketches. All right, any questions, comments, complaints? Yes, no, maybe, I don't know. Hey, coming up this week, Monday, I think, is whenever we're going to put it out. We've got a little section over here where my rosemary plant used to be. The rosemary died off. Well, the big one did. During this past winter, it got a little bit too cold for it. It wound up dying off. Fortunately, it made babies before it died, and I took a whole bunch of cuttings from the babies, so we've got 50 cuttings for rosemary stuck. So we should be able to get a few more. But I'll show you what we did with that space after the rosemary bush died off. Mary did a lot of the heavy lifting, getting the weeds out of the zone and getting it ready. And all I did mainly was come along, smooth the dirt and plant stuff. But we got a whole bunch of nifty little things that you can still get away with transplanting and planting even in the fall. And we'll show you that come Monday, I think. In any case, guys, if you found this video informative or entertaining, you know what to do. I will catch you next time. Good night, everybody.